tenders, people have got back, so we can supply it with, like, the lowest on Megaflex tariffs. But now Paul from Miller, which is from City Power, saying they're taking massive risks, that when this can literally turn around, so how can we get this deal of termination? So he says, Cape Town's going the safest route. They are challenging it in court. And meanwhile, they're just sitting to wait to see what's happening.
Yeah, so I think it's watch what happens to Kurileni. That will be really interesting. And that's in a, and you can see all the politics of that. You know, it could really be interesting politics if Kurileni pulls it off and they're procuring big plants locally. You know, and if as researchers we could get in, not just count the jobs in the plants, but all the backwards and forward linkages around those plants, and then and if they're owning and they can recirculating back into the tax base over the long run in terms of profits, then you have a whole argument that needs to feed into the just transition discourse in building the alliance that needs to be built, a solidarity between the unions facing loss of membership in closing mines with the potential of alternative jobs in new economies. And the work on that has not been done. Has to be done.
Maybe it would be useful to say a bit about the energy democracy trade union.
I
was just prompting Mark to say something about the movement internationally around trade unions for energy democracy. So that's and it has connections with South African's trade unions as well, but that there are a lot of groupings thinking about how not to split the environmental and the workers' agenda, so how to keep the, not to have them at odds with one another.
Can I ask a question? But part of the possibility for remunicipalization in South Africa is because South African municipalities have always had a responsibility for electricity distribution.
Yeah.
So it's kind of almost a natural progression that they take on a bigger role with respect to electricity.
Mm.
What about other African countries where municipalities don't have that responsibility? I mean, I think as far as I know, South Africa is almost the only country where municipalities have that localized responsibility. Have you looked at any of the other African countries and what the possibilities are of similar processes? Because, I mean, it seems to me there that it's much more age-driven and private sector-driven, you know, little World Bank. So I don't know.
Louise Tate at the Energy Research Centre had a paper published recently on that topic, multi-level governance and what. So just type in multi-level governance, Louise Tate.
In the
Simon Marvin also.
Or we could forward it to you.
Yes.
Even better.
Otherwise, then you don't have to pay for it.
But one, the role about development finance institutions in sub-Saharan Africa particularly is like it's shifting from aid to development investment. I think is significant on the one hand, and then also I think there's potential for these ideas. We have had some recent conversations with researchers and students in our group about Kenya and the political opportunities around local authorities and what that might mean, and also in Namibia. So I don't think we are alone in that way.
But obviously we're scouring the African continent for a case where there's more public control, and it's Lüderitz.
Namibian towns.
So Lüderitz owns their own power structures. And it's, you know, I can also boast a little, they're graduates who run the town. So, just to come back to the hard politics, I think the politics for us needs to be thought about at two levels. One is the kind of coalition at the national level around policy alternatives. And that coalition, I think, should be fairly broad. So obviously the key is, and Tasnim Esop has been doing some of the best work to actually get the unions to come to terms with the just transition discourse, so there's already work that's been done there that needs to be built on. But you need to take into account the development finance institutions. So again, maybe off the record, to share what's happened in the development bank. The development bank's target for disbursements this year was 17 billion rand. The actual achievement is 13.5 billion. The difference is what they had allocated for the renewable energy power plant projects that they were going to invest in. So because of the minister's craziness and Eskom's lunacy, the development bank is actually not achieving its targets. And they're very angry about that, because it affects all their bonuses, through all the right down through the levels of management. And they were at the same time, at the same board meeting when they realized this, they were hit by a letter from an environmental organization saying, do you realize by putting money into this coal plant that you want to invest in, you are actually investing in one of the most CO2 intensive coal-fired power plants. Do you really want to do that? And if you do, this is the court case that you might. So these two came together, and the development bank, the board decided, oh, maybe what we should do is lobby to get the renewable energy program reinstated. Now, so I'm just saying that when we think of a broader alliance at around policy at the national level, there are sections, pieces of the state that have an interest in this thing happening. And, you know, as things play out after December, depending on which way things go, renewables could actually come back as the mainstream focus of the national economic policy. So we can't take a long-term perspective when we're in a very short-term political cycle, and we have no idea how it's going to pan out. So that's the one thing. But the second level of our politics must be at the local level. I don't know how we do it. We through our networks, we must find out where are we organized in an area where there is a reasonably uncorrupt local authority. Maybe that's just impossible, I don't know. A reasonably uncorrupt local authority who would be prepared to work with a coalition of activists and IPPs and community trusts around some way of maybe thinking of a municipal or building a municipal alternative, and saying, if there are more renewable energy power plants, would this local authority be able to go out and procure? That would be just to see whether and what all the obstacles to that would be. And I mean, that's partly what the development bank is going to start investigating.
But maybe what are the other ideas for how
what are the other ideas
you can organize around energy?
In the people in the room.
I'm just getting back to these physical obstacles. If as you surmise, the movement against renewables at government level is wrapped up with the potential nuclear deal, what do you think the consequences are for government of abandoning the Russian is that a very, I feel as if we can't really, we unclear about what those consequences might be. It's very difficult to understand.
Yeah. Well, I mean, what I've been told is that all the Russians really have, I mean, they try, when Minister Nene was still the Minister of Finance, he was given a very badly drafted letter to sign at a BRICS meeting. And he was told that the President Zuma wanted to sign this letter, and it was the guarantee. And he refused to sign the guarantee. And really, that was the beginning, that was the end of him. And what I've been told is all that the Russians have is a written commitment by the President, not the Minister of Finance. And that actually doesn't, it's arguable that that doesn't count for, it's not strong enough for the Russians to then hold us to account.
So that
if the politics changes.
Change.
If the politics doesn't change, and the Zuma-Gupta group remain in power, only thing that will stop it is the economics. So, you know, the economic case now is like non-existent. So I don't know what others in other networks have heard. But that's what you hear amongst those who are kind of pessimistic about the possibility of no change and the confidence of the Russians that they'll get it. Yeah. But a reduced version, a drastically reduced version, not that.
Has there been, in building this broad coalition and taking on the politics of this thing, has there been any efforts to build popular educational material around the issues that you've been talking about today?
Well, around the nuclear deal, yes. But